Okay, so let's go through this. You have to find the data, the range of the data represented in this graph. How do you find the range of something?
The highest
and the lowest. So you pick the highest, you pick the lowest. They don't mean frequency, they mean x values. So when we look at a frequency distribution in the histogram, we're looking at the x values. So the highest value that we recorded was a 34, the lowest that we recorded was a 24. So the data ranges from 24 to 34. It has 10. Not the frequency, the data. When we do a dot plot, same thing. Take the lowest point you see, 74. Take the highest point you see, it's a 98, and just subtract them. We're okay with ranges? And ranges, you can't exactly find on your calculator when you do them, but you will see a min and a max. And you can always subtract your max minus your min. Ranges never come out negative either. So you have to find the mean, the variance, the standard deviation, and the range. And the population standard deviation for this. This is population data. Sometimes the problem tells you that, and sometimes you kind of have to infer it. Sometimes it will say sum of, then you know it's a sample. A lot of times they use the word sample when they want a sample. So we take this, we put this in your L1, we do a one-bear stack. What we're looking for is the sigma x. That's your population standard deviation. Did everybody was able to do this and got these answers?
Yes.
Yes.
So you have to tell me if you can't. I'll pull out the calc and put it in. Can everybody do this? Yes. Rule of thumb is you round your mean to one more decimal than your data. Rule of thumb is we should round our standard deviations to 3 because we want it a little bit more exact. However, it makes more sense for us since we don't need that exactness right now. We can round it to our mean because then it makes more sense to say if something has a mean of whatever the mean was. Say the mean was 8. And it has a standard deviation of 3, then I could say minus 3, minus 3, minus 3. It makes more sense to me. If I use a decimal 8.1, then I should use a standard deviation 3.1. You know what I'm saying? It makes a little bit more sense when you lay it out. So for our purposes, you can round your standard deviation to the same as you would round your mean, which is one decimal place more than your data. So if your data isn't whole numbers, you round to the tenths, one decimal place. If it's to the tenths, it has one decimal place, you round it 2 decimal place to the hundredths. Okay. Everybody was able to do these? These were just basic. Put it in your calculator. I like these. I know it's rote examples. You're doing one right after the other, but you're clearing your table out. You're practicing it. It should work well. Range also highest to lowest. If your data is not in order, how do you put your data in order with your calculator? Sort. Just go to stat, come down past the edit to the sort. Let your calculator put it in order for you. Then you take the first one, you take the last one. You don't have to sit there and go, oh, I think 173. Oh, wait, it's 160. Oh, wait, what's my height? Let your calculator put it in order. It makes life a lot easier. And this guy, I don't think I gave you all of these, right? Did I take some out?
Yeah.
Or did we do some? This one was different. Why is this one different than the population ones? Sample, good. Right here it says a random sample. So now it's not going to say to you, P.S., use the SX. You have to know to use the SX because it comes from your sample. The rest of it works exactly the same. Remember, sample starts with S. Use the SX for your standard deviation. Population, I kind of say PO. Look for the O for your population. Everybody can do this. Okay. I'm not asking you to make a table, just asking you to be able to put it in your calc. I think this is pretty wide. Oh. Hopefully this looks better. Okay. This guy's You didn't have to put this in your calc. You could absolutely. It showed you that you had a standard deviation, and it has a mean. Both of them have the same mean. One has a standard deviation of 16, and the other one has a standard deviation of 24. If you take your book and you put your book sideways, you can kind of see. I don't think I can move this picture. No, I can't. Maybe I can. No, I can't. Okay. Sometimes I can rotate these, but this one I can't. So if you turned it sideways, you will see where your data goes. And then you'll see this one, kind of like changes, spreads out. So which one looks more spread out?
A.
A. So should A have the largest standard deviation or the smallest standard deviation?
Larger.
Larger, the bigger one. It's further away from the mean, which makes sense to us, right?
Mm-hmm.
If we're closer together, we have a smaller standard deviation. Okay, I need you definitely to be able to do this one. Now, I like to do the graph with you guys. It makes more sense when we do this. Put your 31,000 here and go up 1,000, 1,000, 1,000. I'm just going to go up on this side, 31,000, 32. And then here's a 33,000 over here. I'm a little bit off. Yes. Is that a? No, that's the mean. Yep, that's your mean. 32,000 is here, and then 33,000 is over there. Now, the other company did this. The other company had a mean of, watch guys, it also had a mean of 31,000, but it had a standard deviation of 5,000. So, most of your data falls between which two standard deviations? Well, that's not, I can't say it that way. Plus or minus one is 68% of your data. When you hit plus or minus two, isn't two unusual, negative two unusual? So do I want to take my chance that it's going to be an unusual thing for me to get that amount of money? Who's going to give me that amount of money automatically? Plus or minus one. Aren't I within this area? I'm asking 33,000. Aren't I close to the mean? Closer to their mean than that mean? Than the first one? Do I hear a yes, no, a yay, a may, maybe?
Hey.
I have no idea what you're talking about. Okay. All right, this one too, it just asked you to compare your standard deviations. I just want you to get used to, if your data is closer together, it has a smaller standard deviation. If your data is further apart, they all have the same means, and your means are all in the middle. They were in the middle, but your data was spread out more. So your first one has a normal curve. Doesn't mean that it has the smallest standard deviation. This guy also has a normal curve. Its standard deviation is the smallest. It's closest to the mean. This one has the largest standard deviation, and the first one had the one in the middle. They ask for your smallest and your largest, your greatest and your least. Everybody can tell that off the graph, right? Okay. Same with the dot plot. I'm looking for the same thing. Standard deviation tells me variability. How far away from the mean do I go? The closer I stay to the mean, the smaller my standard deviation. The further away from my mean, the greater the standard deviation. And it's a little hard to tell between one A and B, but A looks a little closer in here. You probably see it better in your book. B looks a little bit more spread out here. Remember how far away from the mean it is. It's going to make you have a bigger standard deviation. Your empirical rule, that's all you know right now to do this. So we remember, plus or minus one standard deviation is what percent? 68%. If you don't know these, memorize them. You need to know these because I don't give you a chart for these. All I want you to do is base it on your empirical rule. So can everybody make this chart, put the mean in the middle, go up the standard deviations, down the standard deviations?
Yeah. 29 and then what? I thought it was just 39.
I might have changed it. Did I give you 29?
Yes.
Okay. So I gave you 29, so you put the mean in the middle. Your mean is 67. Then you're going to take this, and you're going to go up 4, up 4, up 4, down 4, down 4, down 4. Now, between 63 and 71 is plus or minus one standard deviation. So that's about 68% of your data. So you have to memorize those. And remember, we did this before, too. We said, what if it went from 63 to 78? That's not quite plus or minus 2. So I had to figure out what this little piece was here, because it's not exactly, and subtract it. So we played around with these a little bit. Between what values is 95%, what two standard deviations am I looking for? What's 95%? Which two standard deviations? Plus or minus 2. Is this coming back to you? Okay. Did I give you 31?
No.
No. Okay, but just to hit this, if it gives you an N and says how many of those 75 would do that, remember we just take that percentage and multiply it by, we take 68 by N, by 75 in this case. And you have to round it to a whole number. Which one did I give you of these?
37. We did 37. And we went over it.
We did. Okay.
You go over it again.
So let's do 37 again. So what happens with Chevy Chev is sometimes we don't have a normal curve. This is the only time in this class that we won't have a normal curve. Every time else will be a normal curve. So Chevy Chev says, well, I have a help for you. I can give you a certain percentage of data. I can only do plus or minus 2, plus or minus 3. So actually, 2 standard deviations, 3 standard deviations. Can't do a 1, because it's going to use this formula. If you don't remember that, I will give you that formula tomorrow. So what Chevy Chev says, and sometimes it will say apply Chevy Chev's theorem, sometimes it will say this is not a normal distribution. If it's not normal, we use his. We still have to map this out. You still have to take your mean and figure out how many standard deviations would you be away from the mean. So if I am going to 2, that means I'm going from 96 to 80. Okay? So I need to know from 96 to 80. Those are the numbers that I needed to know. So I put it on this chart, figured this out, plugged my 2 right into here. A 2 is going to give you 75%. A 3 is going to give you 88.9%. If you say 89%, that's fine. That's all he can tell you. Normally, plus or minus 2 gives you 95% of your data. But because this curve doesn't fit the normal curve, I don't know where the skew is. I don't know how deep it is. No one gave me the rest of the data. So he gives you an estimate. You can be guaranteed that at least 75% of your data will fall there. Somehow he has an algorithm that figures that all out. So you're still going to have to do your normal curve to figure out where your standard deviations are. Jillian, you might want to put your phone away and do this with us since you have a quiz tomorrow.
Wait, how do you know it's going to be 2 or 3?
Because it can't be 1. If we put a 1 in here, 1 squared is 1, and 1 minus 1, 0. We have no percent. He can't be that exact. He can estimate. This is more like an estimation. Like if you tell me this data, that you give me the data for this whole classroom for everybody's grades, and you say, well, it doesn't exactly fit a normal curve. I don't know where your grades are. I don't know if they're all high, they're all low. I don't know what threw off your curve. You just tell me it doesn't fit a normal curve. So if you want to know between which two grades, what percentages, and I can't tell you it's 95%, I can give you an estimate. I can be sure 75% of your grades will fall here by using his theorem. The theorem is very basic. Yes. Yes. Or sometimes we will just give you the thing here and say, what percentage of the people fall between 80 and 91? And so then you'll just go here. You'll say, oh, that's 2 standard deviations away from the mean. You put the 2 in. they took a backwards approach. They gave you the two and said between what two numbers and what percentage is it. So you're still going to have to make your normal curve. Okay? And some of you had a little tough time with these. You're just taking them off your graph. This is your frequency histogram. It came from a frequency distribution. Just make a table. L1, L2. L2 is important that you say frequency. So when you do your one-bear stat, you have to make sure you put that in there. It's going to ask for your data, and then it's going to ask for your frequency. You have to say L2 in there, or it will only average 0, 1, 2, 3. It won't give you the correct average. Are you able to do this? These were just taking some off the graph. I like these. The circle graph, it's like our table that had, we're not exactly done yet, Brandon. Oh. If you can wait like another minute. You have to give me a midpoint for this. It's kind of like your class interval. So find the midpoint, and they did use these as frequencies. If they did them as percent, you'd have to flip them to a decimal. But they did use them as frequencies. So again, just make a chart. Does your table have to be in order? No. Was that the end? Oh, and your coefficient of variation. Find your mean and your standard deviation. Mr. Rogers after class. Okay, so did we get this part, guys? Very, very important. Now, you only get, listen carefully. If you forget what this is, Fred, take your headset out. This is for you. If you forget what the coefficient of variation is, what does variation mean?
How much things are different.
How they vary off mean. So what does that represent? Standard deviation. If I have to make a comparison, I only know two things, the mean and the standard deviation. How do I know how to divide them? It's got to be the one that gives me the decimal. If I divide mean divided by standard deviation, I get this number, right? I can't possibly make that percent. So it's got to be, it's got to be standard deviation over the mean. That tells me how close it is. The higher the coefficient, the more varied it is. Okay? So make sure you study this tonight. Tomorrow is a quiz on this. Make sure you study.